Thank you, Sandra, for being able to present and give you an update on the new products at Brain Biotech. We really had some very interesting new developments in the last couple of months with two new exciting projects that we have been able to present to the market, and also the share price has been reacting favorable on this news flow. Let me give you just a quick hint, you know, what makes Brain really so exciting as an investment, as a company to work for. It's a complicated chart with lots of pictures, but I think I can make it quite easy and to show you what megatrends basically Brain Biotech right now is working on. First of all, on the protein base, if you think about vegetarian or vegan food today, you're thinking essentially of alternative proteins to meat. And these proteins need to be produced, for example, by pea protein or via insect materials or via fermentation. And Brain essentially is very active here to re-engineer and engineer essentially the production base for these new proteins. Secondly, on biotech, many of the advances we have right now are made possible out of biotech. One great technology within here is next generation sequencing, where basically the cost of sequencing DNA has come down significantly. And what used to take days and months is basically now done overnight at a very cheap cost, and Brain is active in that area. Secondly, once you have sequenced a DNA, you need to be able to modify it. And here genetic engineering comes into play. And with our new CRISPR-Cas technology, we are developing an own tool right now to accelerate our developments here. And in food-grade microorganisms, we are essentially talking about biofactories, if you want to, also about microorganisms who could then produce better, more sustainable, and particularly more natural industrial food, for example, via fermentation. For customer preference, Brain offers two solutions, either our products business, mainly enzymes within the bioindustrial division, or solution and services within bioscience. We're basically looking at breakthroughs in all of these areas. Sustainability is very important for us. We not only run the business as a sustainable company, but also in particular, our products are targeting at least 5 of the SDGs directly. For example, with compounds in sugar replacement or biological production or green mining or natural compounds or food preservatives. The microbiome is in big part still undiscovered. So we're basically sampling DNA and do RNA detection and using the new use cases of what nature is telling us basically of how to do things. And last but not least, if you think Brain, you should think also all natural. So we are really looking at natural ingredients, for example, for sweetness, for taste, for fermented teas, for new taste profiles in drinks, and trying to do that on an all natural base, but not necessarily using monoplants in nature, but trying to biologically re-engineer this nature and basically do it then within steel tanks within the fermenters. I think that's really a very exciting technology portfolio which Brain has right now. And that's also where our innovations are made from. I just touched about two of the most exciting innovations we have been presenting to the market. It's first of all, the PH1-121, the pharma compound for rare diseases. And secondly, our proprietary CRISPR-Cas genome editing tool, which really is probably the most exciting development within Brain for the last couple of years. And last but not least, Biocatalysts, our most successful bioindustrial daughter company. The capacity already is running at full speed, and we are thinking to accelerate here the production capacity for further growth. So first of all, let me touch upon Pharvaris, or PHA-121, as the compound is called. That is a rare disease, which basically is caused by a medical disorder by gene mutation, and it results in recurrent attacks of severe swelling in patients, so very painful and or potentially lethal to the patients. What Pharvaris is developing here is basically an oral treatment, because right now the standard treatment is basically injection, so there has to be hospitalization for patients. And in the new treatment area, essentially, we're trying to find now an oral receptor antagonist to prevent these swellings in patients. Pharvaris is a development company, has gone as an IPO at the NASDAQ in February of this year and raised about $190 million for the development. And if you ask now what has Brain to do with it, well, Analyticon, our daughter company in Potsdam, has basically found the compound, the small molecule, which basically is now worked on here in these clinical trials. We have done the heat identification, we had to lead a lead optimization for Pharvaris. We gave them access to our extensive libraries, basically re-engineered the peptide in our TMS business. And from here on, we will collect milestone payments, royalties, and once the product is essentially on the market, we will collect royalties here on net sales. So quite an interesting business model. I'll give you some idea is basically how big the market is. So in HAE, we're talking about a $2 billion market with pretty robust growth around 9% CAGR. Preventing hospitalization basically would be significant cost savings here to the healthcare system, i.e. we also could realize probably a very good reimbursement for the drug. There's an issued US patent which expires in 2038, so long patent protection for the drug. And we could collect at Brain via our daughter company, Analyticon, around 11.4 million in milestones if that drug comes to the market. And on top of that, could get royalties in the range of a low to medium single digit amount on direct and indirect sales. So that is a very exciting project for us. I think it shows very nicely how we can basically create long-term value for the shareholders out of our libraries business and out of our tailor-made solutions business. And that project will enter our incubator pipeline right now as a medium-sized project, only medium for the reason that it's obviously is pharma development, so there's high risk at the early stages of that. If you essentially go in the later stage of pharma development, that project has the potential to become a larger, very large project in our pipeline. Now let me go to probably the most exciting project we have right now in all of the oral group. It's called the CRISPR-Cas genome editing tool developed by Brain. Essentially, there's already a leading technology out in the market, the so-called CRISPR-Cas9 technology, which has actually won the Nobel Prize last year. And that is basically the magic tool right now out there in genome editing, which makes genome editing cheap, safe, and also easy to use for most industrial users and also for academia. CRISPR, clustered regularly interspaced short polyandromic repeats, a very complicated word, what the public usually knows and knows much better under the genetic or the so-called DNA scissor. It allows you essentially to cut DNA, so basically the nucleus of our life, and then being able not only to cut the DNA, but also to knock out certain genes or inject new genes. So what used to be a bit of trial and error in genome editing in the old times now has become basically a directed science. So why has Brain now developed an own tool? Well, Cas9 is a very interesting technology, which is well explored and works well, but it's also very expensive technology to use because essentially you will have to buy a license for it. And this license is also not conflict-free, as basically two institutes are right now battling about the IP, i.e. it's a non-conflict-free license you have to buy here, and it makes it very difficult for industrial development. And quite frankly, that license is so expensive that a company like Brain could not have afforded that for their own business. But of course, given that we are ourselves in genome editing, it would be very tough for us basically to be in business without having such a leading technology. So our scientists essentially have found a way to develop a non-Cas9 genome editing tool, which uses the CRISPR technology, but doesn't touch upon the patents of the Cas9 technology. So we basically have freedom to operate with our own technology. What is the status quo today? The status quo is that tool already is validated for genome editing in selected bacteria, fungi, and yeast, i.e. microorganisms. And microorganisms is what really Brain is about. So in industrial biotechnology, we do produce, for example, enzymes on microorganisms. So being able to modify these microorganisms is very much in the DNA of Brain and what our whole business is about. So already that gives us some great operational advantages. Secondly, we have already proven activity in plants. We have done that together with a partner, but that activity still needs to be validated. And last but not least, right now we are exploring to what extent that technology also works in mammalian cell lines, i.e. human cell lines. And if you can prove that technology works here as well, then we would open up quite a big field basically for licensing technology, because then it would also work in diagnostica and pharma. Looking at that, what means for the economic potential of Brain, well, first of all, it would speed up our strain and product development. We can already use it today in projects, so that is already good news for us. We omit license fees for the development of a TMS business, basically to the Cas9 technology, that's also good news. And of course, if you can prove that technology works in plants and it works in mammalian cell lines, there's significant licensing potential, which we can have to the pharma and diagnostica industry and to other players in biotechnology. So very, very exciting business model for us. It will enter our incubator as a project with large risk net present value potential. It could become very large if it accesses and goes on essentially to plants, in particular to mammalian cell lines. So that technology alone, I think, could significantly change the picture of brain going forward if you're successful, develop that technology to market and make a license model out of that. That's our incubator pipeline. And the incubator pipeline, according to most analysts, but also to our shareholders, defines the biggest part of the value of brain today. And I don't want to touch on all the projects. I just want to say we'll have two projects which we're likely to exit within the next 6 to 9 months because we're basically ready to launch at the market. And we have two projects I just explored with PHA121 and the brain CRISPR-associated nucleates, which will enter the pipelines. But you can see that small projects exits and medium-sized to large or large to very large potentially projects will enter the pipeline so that the overall value of our development pipeline of the incubator has increased quite significantly. Let me quickly touch about our products business. The biggest asset which we have in bioindustrial is essentially BioCatalyst, located in Cardiff in Wales. The company has been excellently performing despite Brexit and COVID-19. It's majorly focused on the enzymes business, particularly in the food and beverage industry. And we have just added a 10,000 liter fermenter there at the beginning of the year and commissioned that very successfully. And the capacity is close to 100% capacity already at the moment. So if you're thinking of accelerating the plant expansion there, maybe by a year, and we'll probably enter pre-engineering phases at the end of this year to almost double production capacity at BioCatalysts, giving us a very good and strong growth profile there. Because the business is so interesting, we have also been able to expand our stakes by another 16.7% to 82.2%. And we have put options in place essentially to buy the remainder of the minorities, which we will do as soon as we are able to do it, because it's really an exciting business within our bioindustrial products business. By that, actually, I'd like to end the presentation. If you want to take a deeper dive, have a look at the next slides where I provide some more details on our pipeline products. You can find a lot of information material also on our webpage with the two links provided. And of course, if you have any more detailed questions, give us a shout at Investor Relations. Thanks, Sanjay and C11A for being able to present.
Since you watched this company video until the end, I'm guessing you liked the video, and that's probably because we work very hard to create the most engaging and added value content for you. If you're a company and want to find out how we, at C11A, can make a company video with and about you, please email us at content@c11a.com.